The Lives of the Third Temple, Part 85. I'm Professor Hannes Redderhuis of the First Assembly of Yafashua in South Africa, Pretoria, Montana, also international. Should you require any of the books which I've written, or maybe the restoration of the original Sacred Name Bible, the Rottenham version, the one that was translated in 1860 by Dr. Joseph Briant Rottenham, please contact me at my cell number 0722-367-124. Just go to my website, https://yahvah.co.za. If this is the first time that you're going to participate in the study, you are very, very welcome. Please go to part one, start from the beginning, because you have missed quite a bit of information. It's also very important to subscribe to the channel in order to receive the different notifications of all the studies that we are currently busy with. Please send this link to your friends and family and inform them about the studies. Make sure you have at least have a 1611 King James Bible, pen and writing pad ready. Welcome to Breakfast with Prof Hannes. Hallelujah. You are really welcome. Every morning, 5 days a week, we are entering into study in the Word, understanding what the Word really means. I trust that this study is going to be a blessing unto you in the name of Yahushua. Hallelujah. Now the researcher, the Temple Institute in Jerusalem, makes the following statement. We're going to continue. This is all history, but we need to know it to understand what they want to happen. Why they will want to have a third temple in Jerusalem. No exploration or excavation. The rabbinical prohibition against Jews walking around the Temple Mount has now been extended. The rabbinus next declared that there were to be no exploration, excavation, or even prayer on the Temple Mount. Yet, they continue to acknowledge that the Temple Mount is the center of Jerusalem. That's the Muslims, right? The Temple Mount is the red-hot heart of the city. This doesn't mean that everyone who lives here turns up there in the course of a day, a week, a month, or a year, or even turns his mind to it. He may go through years without giving it a thought, just as a Roman might not think of St. Peter's. Some young Jerusalemites who can't remember a time when Jews couldn't freely and safely go to the wall and take it for granted. Yet even they know that Jerusalem, unlike Rome, is contested. They believe too that whoever holds the holy place, and especially the Temple Mount, possesses the upper hand in city and therefore the country. So we understand that. Everything is going about power. Power, power, power. Power of control. And power of control turns into mind control, which in the end time is a very big role player, which is called mind control. Orthodox Jews in the Temple Mount, in the attempt to minimize tension between Jews and Arabs concerning the Temple Mount, a ban on Jewish entrance was formally posted at the entrance gate of the chief rabbinic of Israel. Jews were thus officially banned from the setting foot on the temple platform. In practice, many Orthodox Jews observe the ban while other Jews do not. The state reason for the ban is that Gentiles as well as Jews are regarded as unclean today and as thus unfit to walk on the sacred mount. The mount is considered so sacred that one is forbidden even to fly over it because the holiness of the sight extends into the heavens. Have you ever heard of this? A plane can't fly over it because they obscure the holiness. Therefore, the Orthodox Jews is allowed only to admire the mount from a distance. The ban will stay in effect, many believers, until the Messiah comes. That's what they believe. Because of the ban, the Jews pray and celebrate it at the Western Wall, an area in earlier times known as the Wailing Wall. Other devout Jews have, despite dispute the reasons for a rabbinical ban, claimed that the Temple Mount foundations are indeed defiled and must be ceremonially cleansed. So the foundations is defiled. Until the new temple is, now you must see what it says, and this is why they want a new temple, a third temple. Until the new temple is complete and ready to be placed into service. Until the new temple is complete, which the third temple, which is actually the fourth temple. Until the new temple is complete and ready to be placed into service, it is permissible for unclean person to visit there and even to work on the building of the third temple. First the temple must be cleansed, then the people, is their argument. Can you believe it? That the people can't even build the temple. How clean were King Solomon? I'm just asking a question. How holy were King Solomon? Having more than 1,000 wives, or 500 wives, and the rest were girlfriends. How clean were he? And he built the temple? Does it make sense? We know from history that when the Hadrian temple stood, stone plaques, some in Latin, others in Greek, were placed in the court of the Gentiles, warning any Gentile not to enter the precincts of the temple at the risk of losing his life. Now, it says, no Gentile is to approach within the balustrades around the temple and the balustrades. Whoever is caught will be guilty of his life own death, which will follow. So if you enter the temple area, you can die. Such, while there were no such letters in later times, for example, when the enclosure became a sacred place for Islam, Muslims were no less jealous to guard the area from the steps of non-Muslims, and threats to kill people trying to enter are recorded in the reports of travelers who came to Jerusalem in the past. These restrictions were partly lifted in the middle of the 19th century, but were reclamped down again when Arab nationalism rose to a peak under the then Jerusalem Mufti Hajar Amin al-Hassinzi during the 30 days of the 20th, during the 30th of the 20th century. There was these days only permit very limited access to the Temple Mount as noted, sometimes for only a few hours a day, and at other times no access whatsoever. So who's controlling the mount area? The Muslims. But that is Israel's ground. The Dome of the Rock was built exactly upon the foundation of King Solomon's temple, so they say. Any attempts by Jews or Christians to pray, read from the Bible, sing or speak openly about their faith are immediately enquished by the ever-zealous and ever-present Arab gods, most of whom are ill-tempered, rude and respectfully to tourists. In all fairness, it should be added that those visitors who treat the Muslim guards and caretakers with courtesies and respect will often receive a warm response. As the Bible says, love covers a multitude of sins. The role of the Jewish, Minister of Religions and Affairs. Now it's very important to listen to this. The Ministry of Religious Affairs have not been sympathetic to those who wish freedom to access on the Table Mount. On June 27, 1967, the day the law regarding the holy place was adopted, the Israel Minister of Religious Affairs said, "It is our standing afar and our disclination to enter the illustrated our wav to receive over to revenge over the site and the former temples." After the city of Jerusalem was unified in 1967, the Knesset passed a law which guaranteed freedom of access and worship to all the holy sites. This law is enforced with sensitivity and diligence over all Israel, with one notable exception, and that is the Table Mount. We understand why now. Throughout, freedom of worship is said to be guaranteed in a person, any open displacement of non-Islamic worship is not allowed. The carrying of a Jewish prayer book on the attempt to pray on the mount is strictly taboo. The police believe that such an act is a threat to the peace because of the Muslim reaction, and indeed the Muslims regard such action by non-Muslims are acts of disrespect for Allah. Hence, the Temple Mount is treated differently by the government from all the rest of the holy sites in Israel. Well, it's understood. It's to be understood. You see, what they do, Islam, is they actually have full control. And that's why, because of the control they have, they won't allow any Jew or Gentile near the mountain. It's not a question of being too holy or not holy. It's a fear that somebody will put a flag up or start a rout, and that's what they fear. On at least four different occasions, the High Court of Justice has heard pleas from Jews to permit freedom of worship on the Temple Mount. Each time they have been denied. One of the reasons that this has not caused more of a furor is a ban on the entrance of the temple compound that has been published by the Chief Rabbinic State of Israel. The holy site is of limits to those who are transgressed in sacred grounds. Former Chief Rabbi Solomon Goren believed otherwise. It was the opinion that only a small part of the Temple Mount area, some 15% of is off limits to the people. Gorian attempts to measure the area at pinpoint whether a worshipper can or cannot stand. It was his contention that worship should be allowed in the large area of the temple compound, but it's not the sacred portions. The problem is that there is no constant consensus of opinion as to where to measure to indicate what parts are sacred and what parts are not. The matter of the fact is they don't want them there. That's how easy it is. And if you can read between the lines here, you will find that this is what is happening. You will find that the Muslims will not allow the Jewish people near the Temple Mount. Chief Rabbi Mordechai Elihu suggested that if a synagogue were to be built, he said, "What? Did I read right? Did you hear right? Listen to the word." Chief Rabbi Mordechai Elahua suggests that if a temple, no, synagogue were to be built, it should be done on the eastern wall of the Temple Mount. Now, after years of my research and studies, I'm 56 years that I'm dedicate my life to the eschatology, Book of Revelation, Antichrist system, New World Order, and for many years, the last 30 years at least, 40 years, 30 years, 35 years, I've been preaching and teaching on different places, especially in South Africa, that they won't build, try to build a third temple, but they will build a synagogue. A synagogue is not the temple. A synagogue, as I explained earlier this week, is a small gathering place like a church. There is no place on the mount, the Holy Mount, to build another temple. But there's place to build a synagogue. And if you can remember the previous person that we dealt with, the researcher, that suggested that they only build, not build the whole temple, but only build the holiest and the holiest of holy. And that will fit into a synagogue. He didn't say synagogue. He only said the holiest and the holiest of holiest, not the outer court and the inner courts and. And now, this chief rabbi now actually suggests a synagogue. Now, this is something to think about. We are just going to stop here because time has caught up with us. And then next week, if it's Yafa's will, we're going to continue next Monday. We will continue. And then you must bring a seatbelt or two, because this is where everything is going to become very interesting. And you might even fall out of your chair. Till next week. Maranatha. Yahshua is coming back again. Hallelujah.